is very good. The swing works, the Oracle again. And the Oracle bowled in. That is out.
Great theatre, magnificent drama.
First match of the season, eh, Howard?
First match of the season, Martin.
King Willow's on his throne and all's right with the world.
Gods and Flannelled Fools. It's from a poem about cricket.
Oh, very apt. How does it go on, my old Howard?
That's the only line I know.
Oh, well, never mind. You certainly made the point.
Hello, and welcome to the Gods and Flannelled Fools podcast, where we will explore our way through the history of English Test match cricket. We're going to start at the beginning and pick up on selected Test series from, well, the very first Test match, actually, through to the present day. My focus is going to be really on honing in on Test series, matches that either featured famous incidents, performances, or in which classic lineups or eras were defined. It's something that interests me, but I'm going to try and make it as non-dry as possible. And where possible, I'm going to put in clips and interviews that I've found that are going to add a bit of interest. Before I launch into things, though, I wanted to basically reiterate why I'm doing this, and just to say that this is the pilot pod. So I'm going to use this to give a bit of an introduction, a bit of background. It's also going to be a slightly different format to the one that I intend to do for each pod. So why am I doing this? Well, I've always been a sports fan, and especially cricket and rugby. I played both from an early age. But cricket really is such a strange game in many ways. If you compare it to rugby, for example, its evolution is really far more convoluted and, I would say, mysterious. Rugby is basically a romantic sort of amateur sport when I first started following England. That was around the time that Will Carling became captain. And then in the 90s, it eventually became professional. And really since then, it's the kind of super professional athletic game with lots of scrutiny that we know. Unfortunately, some of the joy has fallen out of the game in the process, but that seems to be the way life is. With cricket, though, the development from its real origins through to the present day have been stretched out over a far longer period. And you have this sport that is, on the one hand, extremely entrenched in tradition and, you might say, conservative values. And yet, on the other hand, it's continued to innovate its rules and formats right up to the present day, and I have no doubt beyond the present day as well. And in fact, I can't think of another game that has changed into so many different formats and had so many changes implemented. I mean, you think of the change from two innings being the staple to limited overs, and then coloured clothing, safety equipment, technology and decision-making, the introduction of 2020 and now even a 100-ball format. You can't imagine a sport like football, for example, introducing a 30-minute half version or having different numbers of players. And even rugby, going back to rugby, which has the sevens format, essentially retains its core game. But I would say in spite of this continued change, there is no other game that has produced such a myriad of characters, legends, myths. I mean, essentially, its own almost Tolkien-esque history. And it's that I was keen to work through in these podcasts. If you consider for a moment that my earliest memories of watching England play tests go back to the mid-1980s, and I started playing around the late 1980s, perhaps around 1990, something like that. That's now 30 years ago. That's three decades. And massive change has taken place since then. So for somebody a generation ahead of me, That same leap that I've just described would take them back to the late 50s. You do the same exercise again and you reach the late 20s, and once more, and you're pretty much at the birth of the Ashes. So that's four generations covering a huge slab of history. And yet, if we look to the future, how many fans of cricket are confident that the Test match format, as we now know it, will be alive and healthy in 30 years from now? I mean, I'd love to think so. I really would. But I'm not so sure. Because, you know, we live in an age increasingly of cheap, instant, on-demand entertainment. People apparently don't want slow-burning subtlety anymore. And yet, no other game can produce the moment of explosive brilliance that Test match cricket can muster. You know, a Viv Richards or a Kevin Peterson 100 is magnificent because it's played in the middle of such a tense and strategic setting rather than a 20-over slogfest that no one will remember. You know, a succession of wickets from Ian Botham is spellbinding because it comes against the odds at the end of a crucial Ashes match rather than in a meaningless ODI when tail-enders are slogging. So that's it, really. It's the game of chess within Test match cricket. And I thought it would be interesting to work up to the matches that I actually watched by going back in time and exploring a lot of these that are now really consigned to history and trying as much as I can to bring them back to life. There's many things that we know here and there, snippets, characters, things that are referred to when you see somebody take a 5-wicket haul, go past a landmark, score 100, and the digital honours board comes up on the screen, whatever you're watching it on, whether it's Sky or BT, or whether you're watching clips on YouTube or on a DVD. You know, we know a little of some of these characters and series of the past, but I thought it would be interesting to try and work my way back and bring them to life. So here goes.
Now the Yorker bowled in. That is out.
Great theatre, magnificent drama.
So, as I mentioned, in each episode, I'm going to focus on a specific series or match or team or individual. But to kick things off in this pilot, I thought it would be useful really as an exercise to walk through quickly, a brisk walk, the kind of initial history of the game that leads up to the first international cricket matches being played and, of course, the first Test match. This is not going to be in depth. If you're a Wisden editor, which you're unlikely to be listening to this, please don't attack me. But I think it's just interesting to get a sense of how this game developed, especially as it's so complex and at times nuanced. And it obviously didn't all happen at once. So it's been quite interesting for me. I mean, I knew a little bit already. But it's interesting to discover that the sport of cricket has a known history that begins in at least the late 16th century in the southeast of England. There's a feeling that its origins might even date back to medieval times, maybe even Norman times, and it probably does. I remember I did sports history going back a few years, and so many games originate from that period, but it's quite hard to draw a tangible parallel to the game that we now know, and it's possible that some of these games blended in terms of the basic rules. Essentially, the first international matches were played in 1844. So there's at least a couple of hundred years of cricketing evolution that took place up to that point. And the first reference to cricket being played as a proper adult sport was in 1611, when two men in Sussex were actually prosecuted for playing cricket on Sunday instead of going to church, if you can believe that that used to happen. And in the same year, apparently, a dictionary defined cricket as a boys' game, and this suggests that adult participation was a kind of recent development. And then we have a number of references occurring up to the English Civil War, which indicate that cricket had become something contested by parish teams. Something that you can actually see in the evolution of rugby, particularly in France, actually, and some of the culture of development between different villages there. But there's no evidence that counties really had teams at this point. So it's kind of generally accepted that village cricket had developed by the middle of the 17th century. But the real investment in the game and trying to tie it all together hadn't begun. So then kind of that takes to the Civil War. And in sort of around the late 1640s, we've got this new Puritan government, Oliver Cromwell's government, who clamped down on unlawful assemblies, in particular things that they considered to be quite raucous, which included sports like football. And their laws were very much built around things like, you know, stricter observance of the Sabbath. And really, the Sabbath, Sunday, was the only free time available, particularly to the lower classes. So it's possible that quite a few sports, including cricket, might have had a bit of a dip in popularity just for practical reasons during that period of the Commonwealth before Cromwell died and Charles the Second was restored to the throne. But it did flourish in public fee-paying schools. So when we say public schools at the time, we basically mean what we now call private fee-paying schools. Schools like Winchester, St. Paul's, where there was a combination of more freedom, more money, and opposition for the against the roundhead culture, that sort of Puritan culture. There's no actual evidence that Cromwell's regime banned cricket specifically. And there are references to it to this period. But it kind of explains why the nobility in general adopted cricket in this time through the involvement in it as a village game. You know, when we think about cricket, it does have quite a traditional past. There is a sense from some people that it's a gentleman's game. And I think some of it can be attributed to this stage in its development. So it picked up and continued to thrive after the Restoration. And at that point, it enters a phase where it's believed to have attracted gamblers, making quite large bets. There's a newspaper report of a great match being played in Sussex in 1897, which was 11 a side and played for, I think, 50 guineas a side, which was quite a lot at the time. And it seems that gambling problems have blighted, you know, cricket throughout that period. And if you think about, you know, recent years and match fixing and gambling and some of the things, you know, it kind of carries through to the present day. So it's not a new thing of betting causing problems with cricket. And in fact, if you go back in history, there's a really good set of novels out, the Flashman novels, and one of them's called Flashman's Lady. I think it's the fourth or fifth in the series, something like that. And he has a game of cricket for a bet. So there's plenty of references to that. So when you get to the end of the 1600s, freedom of the press is established. And that really means that cricket can be reported for the first time in newspapers. And this kind of brings it to wider attention. So during the first half of the 18th century, we've got press reports focusing primarily on betting rather than the play, which is interesting. But the basic rules of cricket, you know, you've got the bat, the ball, the wicket, pitch dimensions, overs, how you get out, those seem to have been established for quite considerable time at that point. But in 1728, the Duke of Richmond draws up the Articles of Agreement, which basically puts all that stuff together, determines a code of practice, and talks a little bit about payment of stake money, distributing winnings, all the important stuff of your betting. So there's an interesting point. More significantly is a few years later in 1744, the laws are set down for the first time. And then they were amended 30 years later when things like leg before wicket were added, along with things like maximum bat width. And that also, interestingly, this actually came to my attention when I was flicking through a couple of history books, and you see some copies of oil paintings from the time. This was when the middle stump was added to the wickets. Because up to that point, you basically had two stumps and a single bale going across. Interestingly, a single incident led to this development. So there was a man called Edward Lumpy Stevens of Hambledon. I think Lumpy is his nickname for whatever reason. And he happened to bowl three balls at a batsman for Kent called John Small. And these three deliveries beat his defence, but passed through the stumps. And this guy was absolutely livid. And he wasn't just livid, he was out of pocket because of the money at stake, because everything was there was bets on everything. And this basically led to a middle stump being added. Although apparently it was optional for a few years until the two stump format eventually fizzled out. Now this guy, Lumpy Stevens, who sounds amazing already with a name like that, he was also notable in that he bowled through the air. So the original form of bowling was a bit like bowls. In other words, rolled on the floor. But in the second half of the 18th century, bowlers started to pitch the ball, really, from a height. And from that, really work with things like line, length, and obviously, by extension, variations. So in response to this type of bowling, the bat began to evolve from what it was originally, which was more of a sort of early hockey stick style piece of wood, a curved piece of wood, to a straight bat that could cope better with a ball flighted as well as pitched. The other thing about this period where it's all happening, all this evolution is taking place, is we see the maintenance of a scorecard. So that's the thing really that turns it into a well-managed sort of documented sport. And, you know, you think about the whole mechanism of scoring. There's not really another sport I can think of that has scoring done to such a fine art as cricket. You know, you go, even playing village cricket, you know, you'll always see someone with a scorer's book, putting all the dot balls down, recording maidens, the number of balls a batsman's faced. That does seem to be something that was established fairly early on. So if you think about the kind of organisation and the clubs, most of the early clubs included, London, which is quite a broad catch-all, but of course London wasn't the size that it is now. Dartford, along with a number of smaller clubs sort of across that home county's southeast area. The most famous club this time, though, was Lumpy Stevens' own club, which was called Hambledon in Hampshire. A real village club in the present sense. It's still a village team now. But back then, it actually held all the power and in many cases ran the game in terms of rules, regulations, and the general evolution and administration of the game. You can't imagine that now, but that all changed at the end of the 18th century when the Marylebone Cricket Club was formed in northwest London, and a new ground called Lord's was opened. That was in 1787. It could have turned out very differently. The home of cricket could have been in Hampshire. I think around this time as well, and this is another interesting one, we see the evolution in bowling that led basically to round arm bowling being allowed. And that in turn would eventually progress to overarm bowling that we now know. That's the form that we accept today. And it sort of, you know, that's the point at which this even contest, or so it appeared, between bat and ball was kind of set. So there's sort of little move aheads in terms of what repertoire a bowler has, and then the batsman, and then the bowler, and at that point everything seems to level out. So round arm bowling is an interesting one. I mean, you could, obviously we've got no footage of the time, but you sort of think of someone like Malinga in the present day, the Sri Lankan fast bowler, the more slingshot type of action. And obviously there's been some controversy around bowling actions, mainly spinners, but even fast bowlers, some of them have had their actions scrutinised over the years. So obviously they wouldn't have had the science back then, but it seems to be that overarm bowling and some of the laws and governance around then came into place. So when we get into the 1800s, a number of county sides begin to emerge, starting again with the southeast, so Sussex, but then the likes of Yorkshire get involved. And really, with the expansion of the road and railway network, as we get well into the 1800s, as part of the Industrial Revolution, the game begins to grow nationally. And then, of course, as the British Empire is expanded, we have colonial expansion, and the game is sort of taken abroad. People could travel to play and watch cricket. Grounds begin to develop, you know, facilities to house people to watch, spectators. And crucially, pitches became flatter and less like fields and more like playing surfaces. So, you know, it was facilitated in terms of the environment that it was played in. Notably, the first Wisden almanac was published in the mid 1800s, in the mid 19th century, and it was around this time, of course, that W.G. Grace began to play. But we'll have more of that in due course. It was in 1844, as I mentioned earlier, that the first ever international game of cricket was played. But just take a moment to guess who it was between. Have a few seconds just to guess which two international teams contested the first international game of cricket. It was the US and Canada. I mean, you'd never guess that. In New York, that famous cricket-playing city. And 15 years later, a group of the best English players travelled to North America for what became the first overseas tour. And 5 years after that, the first English team toured Australia. So that takes us up to 1862. So probably before we sort of race our way up to the very first test match, something else that really interested me is the number of balls in an over. So quite interestingly, cricket started with four balls per over. And in 1889, the first, the four balls per over, that was replaced by five balls per over. And then by 1900, that went to six balls per over. And then in the early part of the 20th century, some countries experimented with eight balls per over. And in 1922, the number of balls per over was changed from six to eight in Australia only. And in 1924, the eight balls per over was extended to New Zealand, and in 1937 to South Africa. In England, eight balls per over was not moved to until 1939, so just pre-World War II. But obviously, yeah, in 1940, you've got the suspension of first-class cricket for the duration of the Second World War. When cricket resumed after the war, English cricket reverted to six balls. And in the 1947 update of the laws of cricket, it allowed six or eight balls, depending upon the conditions of play. And since the 1979-1980 Australian New Zealand seasons, six balls per over has been used worldwide. So that's been standard. And the most recent version of the laws in 2000 only permits six ball overs. So that one was interesting. I've skipped forward, obviously, up to the present day, but I think there's quite an interesting evolution there. And I think with a lot of the talk about different formats now, just looking at how the history has evolved, I suddenly feel a little bit more relaxed about changing things like that, being as it's changed over time. So history tells us that the game can cope with these things. But it just feels right. I mean, as a bowler, I would expect to have six balls as a batsman. That's what I would be facing. And as an umpire, I used to enjoy umpiring when I was playing. And I'd have my five stones in my pocket or my counter or whatever, six coins. It just feels natural, but that's not always been the case. So there we go. So in a period of around about 250 years, we go from more or less the first mention of cricket through to its formation, its regulation, and its evolution into the game we now broadly follow. So I think we can now talk about the very first test.
That is very good. The swing works, the Oracle again.
I am now going to bring us up to the year 1877. So what's happening at this time? We've got, actually, in 1877, Queen Victoria, who's been on the throne for a number of years, is proclaimed Empress of India by the Prime Minister, Disraeli. We've got early photographs in black and white form, probably sepia, but no film and, of course, no TV yet. The Boer War is a couple of years away, and this really is the height of the British Empire. So in this year, 1877, 15 years on from the first tour to Australia, England tour the country again. And they play two matches that are now regarded as the very first test matches ever played. The first takes place on the 15th of March, 1877, at Melbourne. And the second, at the same ground, on the 31st of March, so a couple of weeks later. So you think about what was known as the centenary test in 1977. That's what it obviously refers back to. Now, there's not a huge amount to note, so I'm not going to spend too much time on it. Aside from the milestone itself, basically Australia won the first test by 45 runs in a very low scoring game, and England won the second. Around 4,500 people turned out to see the first day's play, including apparently quite a few people who managed to sneak in for free. I dare say that they weren't aware of the significance at the time, so probably didn't dine out on it too much. But what's interesting, when you read the scorecard on a site like, Crick Info, if you go back to Wisden, if you can locate a copy of that age. In fact, if you've got a Wisden relating to that year, you could probably sell it and retire. But basically, all of the players were by definition making their test debut. Both umpires were Australian. Neutrality was, I think, assumed back then. It was a gentleman's sport and all that. As I say, they had four ball overs. They had a rest day between day three and four. Now, that's something that was taking place when I first started following cricket, which was over 100 years after these first tests. And in terms of individual kind of things of note, in Australia's first innings, a gentleman called Charles Bannerman made 165, and he was actually injured, so he was retired hurt. I'm just checking the scorecard here. What I'm going to do is I'm going to post all of these things. So by the first episode, I'm going to provide some links where I'll post some information on what I'm talking about. But he retired hurt. He'd got an injured hand. And obviously, he became the very first Test Centurion in a score, and this is the real interesting thing, in a score of 245. So the side were bowled out for 245. He made 165. And it's, you know, that's a remarkable effort. Nearly 70% of his side's runs came through his own score. And that is still a record to this day as a percentage. So there you go, Charles Bannerman. In the second test, it looked like England got their act together. They managed to knock off the runs in another low-scoring game to win by four wickets within 4 days. I think only a couple of 50s were scored by the same batsman in that game. So the series was drawn without too much of a palaver or anything exciting. But they were the first test matches, and that was the first test series. Now, the other thing to note, and I'm sure we'll come back on this on a number of episodes, is that these were both timeless tests. In other words, there was no limit on the number of days that they could have gone on for. But as I say, I'll talk about this in the this long lost format of Test cricket in future episodes. So yeah, over the next 5 years, we've got a handful more tests, all played between the same two sides. But until, crucially, the match report that followed England's defeat at the Oval in 1882, none of them were referred to as what we now call the Ashes. And that's what I'm going to cover in the very first episode proper. So I hope you enjoyed this. As I say, it's a pilot. It's just to get me up and running with this. The whole idea wasn't to give a comprehensive history of the game. So as I say, I've run through that to get us up to the starting point, really. I've got clips, I've got quite a few interesting series to cover. So as I say, I'll be posting some links where you can follow updates on this. I hope you enjoyed it, and until the next time, bye for now.